Welcome to another episode of Out of Thinaer. My name is Beverly, and today we have two guests with us. We have William Wachlin, Partner Account Manager at AWS, and we have Tim Wilson, IoT and Solution Specialist at AWS. Thank you so much for joining us. And today we'll be talking about AWS and the partner programs that you have. So why don't you get started and introduce yourselves. William, why don't we go with you first?
First of all, thank you so much for having us today. I am a Senior Partner Account Manager here at AWS, and currently I help with defense industrialization. So we're always looking for new solutions to help defense manufacturers that are already deployed on AWS GovCloud or higher. And our team is all about helping defense manufacturing modernize to meet today's requirements.
Awesome. Great. How about you, Tim?
Yeah. Hey, thanks again for having us. So I'm a, as you mentioned, IoT and solution specialist. I work in our worldwide public sector global industry solutions team. And I work alongside Will to kind of help build out the portfolio of partners and solutions that can bring IoT and other advanced manufacturing capabilities to our defense industrial customers to really, you know, help modernize their operations.
Wonderful. Great. Well, let's start first off by learning more about the industry. So since you work with a lot of defense contractors and partners, what are some trends that you're seeing across the government and its defense manufacturing partners when it comes to IoT in particular?
So customers are really looking for the ability to track and monitor their assets in real time or close to it in order to prevent loss and waste. They want the ability to automate 5S, and they also, they're looking to increase their throughput and their capacity in their factories and production lines.
Yeah, and I can give some examples there. So one that pops to mind is working with a customer. They have a electronics, pretty good production lines building electronics, like PCBs, electronic devices. They have a lot of different coatings that they have to keep at specific temperatures, expensive. They have different expiration dates. And so they were actually having having problems around refrigerators, you know, going down or going out of spec. And, you know, so we're, you know, just talking through simple problems like that, where it's actually a lot harder in this space to, you know, how do we retrofit that particular refrigerator to have the right set of sensors to then get that data to the right people to trigger alerts. And so, you know, while that simple problem, you know, on the surface actually is a lot more complex, as you might solve that one problem, it might be somewhat bespoke, kind of pieced it together. But then how do you actually scale that to the next problem, whether that's more refrigerators or just another kind of use case? Like, how do you scale that next problem? And so, you know, we definitely see a lot of that, those types of problems. Like, how do we actually bring technology to, like, give that visibility into those little problems that actually impact the downstream production, for that particular line? And then so there's also this tendency, I think we have a lot of interesting new technologies, machine learning that's coming out. And it's like, how do we apply some of this automation to these kind of stuck production lines that we might have, but then not having the actual fundamental visibility into what's going on the factory floor on these assets. So it can't even make the decision of, like, what do we even automate? We don't even have the visibility to see, you know, what to automate on the factory floor. So, like, the worst thing you can do is spend a bunch of money and time and automate the wrong thing. So, you know, really looking at IoT to give that visibility into the factory floor and then layer on top all those, you know, new technologies that are coming out.
Interesting. So you mentioned visibility. How does the defense industrial base currently track assets in their factories today?
You know, depending on if an asset is tracked at all, whether that's a part, raw materials, or a large machine like a CNC machine, we will see everything from, you know, basic Excel spreadsheets, paper processes, whiteboards. Asset data, you know, may be tracked via barcode scans, you know, and pushed into ERP or MES systems or other kind of warehousing systems. But it really, the visibility into that data is really only as accurate as the last time someone had eyes on it, you know, took a note about it, put it in an Excel spreadsheet, or even put it into that large enterprise system. And we do see some technologies apply, like RFID, but that's typically for expensive or large assemblies, and, you know, for tracking, like, work in progress for you know, very specific assemblies of, you know, expensive set of parts maybe. But once again, like, that's if you're looking for like location data, it's only as accurate as the last time that particular assembly or that part, you know, went through and was able to be scanned via the RFID scanners.
Yep. And Beverly, can I just say that we do love how the Thinaer solution solves this for defense manufacturers. You know, once you tag an asset, you'll always know where it's at on your factory or warehouse floor. You know, you shouldn't have to do cycle counts at the end of the day to find out where these pieces are at on the floor, right? Having done plenty of cycle counts and inventory myself, I'm aware of how much time you can spend doing such things. And so the fact that you make that so much simpler and that you're already deployed in GovCloud today, I think you really solve a major pain point for many, if not all, defense manufacturers today.
Wow, interesting. And so for these defense manufacturers, typically, how do they store telemetry from machines and assets in their factories?
Many factories that we see, unfortunately, they are not connected to the cloud at all. And if data is collected at all, it's probably stored locally and not available to the users and systems that need it to drive decisions, right? And there's a lot of reasons why, right? These solutions are often not compliant for heavily regulated industries. There's solutions out there. There's plenty of COT solutions, but they're not designed in such a way to be compliant the way our defense manufacturers need them to be.
Yeah, and I'll add to that. In some cases, some customers are in this industry are connecting machines. For example, like a CNC machines and a machine shop. These modern machines are producing data tags in formats like MT Connect or OPCUA. And you know, we do see customers that are storing some of that data in industrial data lakes in the cloud. But then they also want to augment that data with additional metrics like vibration or temperature, humidity, or even, you know, monitor the unconnected assets that might be feeding those connected assets. So whether that's like coolant pumps or, you know, conveyance that might be feeding that CNC machine. If those other assets that feed the machines are, you know, going down or they don't have the visibility into that in particular, that might be starving that CNC production line because, you know, something upstream of them is broken. There's also cases where you might want to track the kind of ambient conditions in the factories for that particular production line. So you can actually start correlating, hey, we're having, you know, we're having some kind of production deviation happening here. Is that related to some humidity that's elevated for a particular time of the day? But ultimately, I think customers are really looking to collect that data off of the shop floor, off of the warehouses in their operations, and make that data available in the right context. I think that's a key part to it too. It's not just like, let's just throw data willy-nilly into the cloud and then let people kind of figure out what that data means, you know, once it gets there, but actually providing more context around that data so that we can enable the frontline operators, we can enable the plant managers to look at that data to drive decision or, you know, automatically trigger alerts based on that data to react to a particular problem that might be happening on the production floor. And then, of course, taking that data and integrating it with the other systems, to whether that's to, you know, train analytical models, but ultimately improve that kind of that availability, quality, and ultimate performance of the factory.
Great. And I guess stepping back a little bit, what are challenges that federal and defense industrial-based customers are seeing in regards to IoT?
I think it goes back to that one of the first questions we were talking about, which is, hey, this is a seemingly simple problem, but you quickly, you know, with IoT solutions can quickly become kind of bespoke systems that are cobbled together and they become really hard to scale or adapt to different use cases across the enterprise or organization. And so I think customers are looking for more of that like end-to-end solution that not only provide like the sensor to kind of cloud data connection to the cloud, but also provides the analytical capabilities, the operator dashboards, the set of alerts for the end users to really integrate with the systems and the kind of operational flows that they've deployed across the organization or the business. On top of that, you know, this is a regulated industry. So the need for, you know, I can't always just go pull the next set of sensors and gateways, you know, willy-nilly from wherever. Our customers are looking for vetted set of sensors. They don't want to spend time doing that. and then the IoT and cloud environments that are compliant with the various regulations and a set of security controls that they operate under.
I've had the privilege of going on several factory tours in some of our largest defense manufacturers. And, you know, something that has always struck me is the lack of telemetry and the lack of computer vision. And it's frustrating knowing that those capabilities are out there, but our large defense manufacturers haven't been able to use them. And that has frustrated me for quite some time. So when I first heard, you know, that you, Thinaer, are deployed in, you know, defense manufacturers' factories and you are pulling telemetry off of machines, I was like, wow, this is great, because we really do need to help our defense manufacturers modernize. And I think that what you bring to the table is, I kind of feel like a tidal wave of change is coming. And I truly believe that the Thinaer AWS partnership is really going to continue to help more and more defense manufacturers in the future, help them save money, help them increase throughput, build things faster, right? These are all known needs for our defense manufacturers.
Great. And do you see any challenges in integrating IoT solutions into other systems that may be existing?
Oh, absolutely. Right. So a lot of our defense manufacturers, they've been operating the same way for decades. These factories aren't connected to the cloud. Sometimes they're resistant to the cloud for a multitude of reasons. It could just be they think cloud is unsafe or they don't have budget. There's a whole bunch of reasons why they're not. But if we're going to produce defense products the way we need to produce them, that has to change. And you truly do bring a whole suite of capabilities that did not exist before. The ability to track assets as they move around or even in between factories. The ability to track up to 40 types of data coming off of a defense manufacturing machine. It's just amazing.
I think, you know, maybe I can answer that from a little bit on the technical side, and it might sound like I'm a little bit of a broken record, but kind of going back to some of the previous answers that I made to other questions, which, you know, if IoT solutions are cobbled together, they probably don't have like a stable set of APIs, access methods to the underlying data is not available to the systems or the people or applications that need it. And then, you know, going back to the context piece too, that's great. We want to integrate that data with an existing business system, whether it's, you know, MES, ERP, whatever it might be, some kind of frontline application, but without the right context, you know, you end up spending a lot of time, a lot of work trying to like massage that data into the right formats or massage that data, putting the right context around it, figuring out that integration piece. If we're looking at the Thinaer piece of this, like not only do you provide sensors to data into the cloud, but then also providing the data context, the APIs to easily integrate with those existing or future business applications, whether that's ERP, MES, frontline applications, analytic systems, or even just providing that data for future AI or generative AI type of use cases that the business is looking to build.
So looking at the future, what do you think a future defense smart factory and supply chain will look like?
I think in the future, defense manufacturers will be able to have complete visibility into manufacturing operations. I think predictive maintenance is taking place in the future. Automated notifications are enabled, right? When a machine starts to act up, that telemetry will indicate to an automated system that a work order needs to be placed. And someone comes in and looks at that machine without someone manually putting in a trouble ticket. And I also think that, you know, in the future, Gen AI will provide customized work order instructions to the workers on how to fix this. So those are some of the things I think are coming.
I'll add to that. I think true kind of real-time visibility into the assets, materials, everything that moves through the supply chain, real-time visibility into the performance and kind of capacity and availability of the factory itself. Obviously, we see a lot with Gen AI. So applying Gen AI to take in that data, taking all the data across the enterprise to provide accurate, real-time, automated, you know, next best decisions based on, let's say, like the supply chain data, you know, when disruptions occur. You know, we have customers that are like, how do we flex or surge and adapt our production lines to meet schedule? Or, hey, we've got a new geopolitical event that's really changing things. Like, how do we surge to meet that emergent demand? So whether that's, you know, at that kind of macro level, hey, I've got really good visibility into like the supply chain as there's disruptions overseas. But then, you know, a lot of times it's actually closer to home and it's that hey, I have visibility through my local supplier chain. A lot of our customers will talk about like, I don't know when parts are going to land on my loading dock. So how do I actually adapt to my production line when I don't know what's coming next? And so visibility all the way back through that. So, oh, I know supplier A, B, C, or D is slipping and I can adjust and I have the tools and I have the analytical capabilities to, you know, almost automatically based on, hey, supplier A is slipping or shipment's late. I know exactly what to do. I can bump the schedule. I can easily flex and adapt my production based on all of this data.
Okay, so last question, and still on the topic of future trends, how do you see IoT solutions expanding across the government and defense manufacturers? You mentioned a need to modernize. What do you see as coming down the pipe?
With the cloud and certainly AWS as a key partner here, the ability to securely scale these types of solutions across the enterprise is definitely the foundation. But what's super important, this goes back to the conversation about integrations, is that we see these strong partnerships between kind of the IoT asset tracking and monitoring solution providers like Thinaer, and whether it's the existing enterprise application vendors or the new applications providers or new partners that are driving other types of innovation with these customers. It seemed like really strong partnerships and integrations between all of those different systems. I think that's key to really seeing this expand.
Yeah, you know, so Beverly, I'll tell you, we've been looking for caught solutions to defense industry problems for quite some time, both inside and outside of AWS. And it's exciting to come across, you know, Thinaer. When I first heard about what you all were doing, I was like, could this be it? Could this truly be the asset tracking and telemetry solution that we've all been hoping for? And I believe that the answer is yes. You are that caught solution that defense manufacturers can readily deploy in their factories and in their AWS GovCloud environments today. It's just incredibly exciting because let's face it, it's not easy to make your product GovCloud compliant. It's not easy to work in the defense manufacturing space. It's highly regulated. That creates some significant barriers to entry. So the fact that you've already broken through many of those barriers and you're delivering value today to defense manufacturers, it's truly exciting. I'm excited to see what this partnership is going to bring, you know, a year from now, 2 years from now, 3 years from now. I think there's the potential to completely revolutionize the way that defense manufacturing is done today. So kudos to Thinaer for what you all have built.
Well, I will say thank you on behalf of Thinaer. And thank you also for being our guest today. We learned a lot. And we are also really thrilled with this partnership. I think it'll add and bring a lot of value to the industry. So yeah, we're looking forward to doing great work and providing great solutions. So thank you again, Tim and William, for joining us on this episode of Out of Thinaer.
Thank you so much for having us.
Thanks so much, Beverly. It's been great.
Great. And thank you for watching and listening at home. Remember, please to subscribe and like and share the video. Thanks. Bye.